If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Matthew 22. We're going to work out of that passage a little bit. We've got other passages that we'll be looking as well. But this week, being Love Day, Valentine's Day, we are kicking off a whole new series called As You Wish. Who's seen the movie The Princess Bride? Who enjoyed the movie The Princess Bride? Some of the hands actually went down. A good number of them, actually. More hands than I was hoping for. It's an interesting movie. I don't even remember what year it was made. But it's an oldie. I actually think it's kind of a good one. Who actually enjoyed the movie? Who's like, yeah, it's good, right? And I have a whole list, actually, of quotes from the movie. You know, so all kinds of things. No more rhymes, now I mean it. See, you guys, you know the movie, you know, so it's great. And nobody would really fear the dread pirate Wesley, right? So he's got his name to lift up. But, or R-O-U-S, anybody know what that acronym stands for? Rodents of Unusual Size. See, so I'm not the only geek with this movie or fan of this movie. But in that movie, there's a particular line that is used that is a true love kind of line. In fact, I think we have a little clip to illustrate this line. So you kind of get the premise behind this video or this movie.
The Princess Bride by S. Morgan Stern, Chapter 1. Buttercup was raised on a small farm in the country of Florin. Our favorite pastimes were riding a horse and tormenting the farm boy that worked there. His name was Wesley, but she never called him that. Isn't that a wonderful beginning?
Yeah, it's really good.
Nothing gave Buttercup as much pleasure as ordering Wesley around.
Farm boy, polish my horse's saddle.
I want to see my face shining in it by morning.
As you wish.
As you wish was all he ever said.
Farm boy, fill these with water. Please.
As you wish.
That day she was amazed to discover that when he was saying as you wish, what he meant was, I love you. And even more amazing was the day she realized she truly loved him back.
Farm boy.
Fetch me that pitcher.
As you wish. And you picture it in that setting, and it's just kind of this romantic, endearing, and sappy kind of their scene, right? It's really cute. So we're not doing the whole series based on that movie. But just so you know the premise, we'll throw in plenty of cheesy lines. So you connect with the movie a little bit. But I'll just warn you, there's a couple times where there's a little bit of crass language in the movie, so I'm not just saying in the movie, I'm like not giving a full stamp of approval, but it's really cute in a lot of the things that they have in there. So the thing is, just a little working definition for you, as you wish, this phrase is literally to demonstrate this unconditional love by meeting the true needs of those you love by serving them in relation, ultimately, to God's plans. Now, this movie doesn't take that bent to it, but demonstrating love by serving, and not just serving, you know, in silly little ways, although those can be good, but serving by helping go in a certain direction, and leading in that proper attitude of loving through serving. So, how many ladies in here ever dreamed of getting married? Wait, like before you, like when you were younger, or maybe you are younger, and you're like, oh, I dream of getting married one day. And, right? Honest, ladies, honest in the room, okay? You dream, maybe you planned the wedding out. You'd drive by a dress shop, and you like, I want that one, right? And the guys are going to wear that, and it's going to be this kind of cake, and you know, going to have the perfect house. What gals in here, you had a crush on a guy, and you wrote your first name and their last name 100 different times in a notebook, right? Like 100? Thousands? What are you talking about, right? You have these dreams of the perfect guy, and you're going to have kids, and it's all going to be beautiful, right? And so maybe you even like have the names picked out for the kids, right? Who pre-picked their kids' names prior to even knowing your husband, right? Some of you did, some maybe not. So many gals dream of this. They dream of what it's going to be like. And guys, many guys, statistically, most guys don't dream about the wedding. Sometimes don't even dream about the marriage. They usually dream about one thing. And it's sex, multiple times a day. Statistically, that's what they dream about. I'm not asking for a show of hands on this one today. Okay? And I'm going to clarify, because some people are like, you're just trying to do that to shock. No, sex is a good thing in the right context. Okay? God invented it. It's talked about a lot in the Bible. A lot. Okay? So don't think I'm just trying to shock anybody. But a lot of guys, this is how we think. And some guys are still dreaming. Haven't gotten there yet. And we're exploring marriage. We're exploring family. We're exploring these wonderful things that God has made and God has set up. And that sometimes we wonder if they're even attainable. Because we get going in a relationship, whether you're dating or you're married, and sometimes those relationships don't work out very well. Anybody's heart ever been broken in a relationship? You've been hurt by somebody. Most of us have experienced some kind of hurt in our relationships, been let down. And we have a lot of expectations. This is what marriage is going to be like. This is how it's all going to go. We're going to have a 3-bedroom house with 2.5 kids and a white picket fence, right? Statistically, isn't that how it works? So we have these expectations of what it's going to look like. Until we get going into it, and oftentimes we face hurt, and we face pain, and we face difficulties, and we're like, wait a minute, this isn't what I signed up for. Anybody know what I'm talking about? This isn't how I dreamed it to be. This isn't what I expected. And many people often then wonder, is it possible to have a great marriage? Is a great marriage possible? They wonder that. And I would say, I would agree with several people here that said amen, a little Pentecostal, hoorah. I'm not sure where that came from. Amen. I'll just blame it on the electricity periodically if something random comes out. But I would say emphatically, yes, a great marriage is possible. Is a great marriage likely? No. It's not likely. If you do what everyone else does, if you follow the pattern you see around you and how everybody else is conducting their marriage, handling their affairs, their financial, or how they keep their financial house in order, their relational, their time clock, how they keep all that stuff in order, if you follow their pattern, you will probably not have a great marriage. And that's what we're going to be exploring and unpacking in this series. Because men, 50% statistically, and the statistics change, but statistically, 50% of marriages that start end in divorce. And of those that continue, many of them are miserable. Why is that? I don't know about you, but that is not how I see what my God planned for marriage. That is not how it should be. That is not what I'm experiencing. And I don't think that that's what you should be experiencing. Now you ask Mel, and she will have she could probably write down a nice list of ways that I've messed up in the last 16 years. I think we've actually known each other for 30 years, or close to 30 years, and been married for 16, almost 17 of those. And she's got some dirt on me. So I would encourage you, do not ask her. My best advice. But 50%. Are you satisfied with 50%? I am not satisfied with 50%. Because 50% is not acceptable in any other form in my life. If you told me that if I went to the bank and gave them $1,000, I would get 50% of it back, I'd be like, I'm not using a bank. Period. I don't want it. If you told me that I get in my car and I have a 50% chance of dying in a car crash on my way home, I would walk. Right? If you told me that 50% of airplanes that take off crash land, I would not get in one. 50% is not an acceptable statistic, is it? It's not a thing that we allow in our lives. If I told you that 50% of you who own cats would be attacked and mauled by that cat, you'd probably get rid of that cat. I pray and hope, right? It's probably more like 80%, but that's another matter. It's not an acceptable policy. And yet in marriage, we approach it the same way they do in Princess Bride. And in this wonderful quote, said to the bride, basically, I think it was Wesley that said this, he said, "Life is pain, Highness. Anyone who says differently is selling you something." That was his mindset. Life is pain, Highness. Anybody who says anything else is selling you something. And many people are in their marriage and are like, this is just the way it's got to be. My kids are always going to be fighting me. It's always got to be miserable. My spouse is always going to hate me. And we're never going to get along. I'm never going to be able to achieve what I dreamed of. I have to give up my dreams. And many people in their marriages have surrendered to that. And I pray that through this series, that you can come to a point in your marriage, in your parenting, in your finances, in your character as a man or woman, that you can come to a point where you can once again dream, where you can once again enjoy what God has given you. And God has said, when God first gave a woman to a man, said it is good. It is a good thing. He created this helpmate as to be a helper, not a hindrance, not a pain, but a helpmate. And I think that we as a church, if we decide to stop doing what everybody else is doing because we think we'll get something different, we start doing what God said. Anybody in here, you're God? You are God. You'd stand up and say, I'm God. We'll probably escort you out and bring you to some special home, okay? We all have to come to a point where we acknowledge that I am not God. There is a God, and I am not him. And the one that is real, he knows a whole lot more than I do. And maybe if I follow his ways, things will turn out a little better. They might not be the cool way. They might not be the easy way at first, the fun party way. But his ways are better and way better in the long run. And I'm praying that we get this. The thing is, in our culture, I think this is insane. Especially if you're like 14 to 18 years old right now and you're really like wanting to drive, it's a lot of work to get a driver's license, isn't it? It's money, hours behind a wheel, all the classes, all this work to get a permit, right? Isn't it? I mean, or am I just behind the times? Maybe they just hand those things out nowadays. Here's a cell phone and a car. Go for it, right? It's a lot of work. But to get married, you pay $15 and you go have Elvis take care of the ceremony for you. Something's wrong with the picture, isn't it? We think it's a lot of work to drive, but it's easy to be married. And there's something wrong with that picture. So we as a church, we want to invest in your marriage. We want to invest in your parenting. We want you to succeed. We don't talk about parenting because we want to run your household. We don't talk about money because we want all your money. We want you to have blessings in your home, abundance and joy, even if you don't think it's possible, especially if you don't think it's possible. So we want to invest in that. I believe that marriage is a very sacred thing that God established to be between a man and a woman forever. Now, we live in a fallen world that has really broken that up. And if you're here and you've gone through painful things and you've had a hurtful marriage or whatever it might be, we are not here to condemn anybody. I believe that God will meet you exactly where you are and begin a healing process. And God is in the business of restoration and healing and bringing back joy when it's been lost. But I also believe that God has a very clear and laid out plan on how this works. One man and one woman for life. And he can heal any other variation of that. So I believe that any couple planning to get married needs to go through premarital coaching. You need to get some steps in place, and it should be done by a pastor or somebody who can speak godly principles into your life and give you tools to be able to live out marriage, live out this married life. And we're going to explore a little bit of why. But the thing is, marriage, our country has boiled it down to a piece of legal paper so you can get rights and benefits in case somebody dies or they're in the hospital. And it's boiled down to a few more things than that, but it's a contract where I believe it is a covenant between two people and God saying, I commit through the hard and the easy, through the joy-filled and the not-so, to stick it out with you. Almost 17 years ago now, Mel and I exchanged some vows, and who's married in the room? A bunch of people, right? Married people, I want to clarify this, married people are not better than single people, okay? They're just a different stage in life. Single people, who's our single men and women in the room? Above the age of 18. Say, lift your hand up high, lift them up high, nice and high, look around, see the hands that are up, okay? If anybody starts a dating relationship because of this, you are more than welcome to name your first child after me. I'm just kidding, kinda. those of you that are married at one point exchanged vows very similar to this, where, and I said this to Mel, that I aim is to take you, Mel, to be my wife, to have and to hold from this day forward, for better or for worse, in sickness and in health, richer or poorer, forsaking all others, being faithful to you as long as we both shall live. So help me God, and in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We made, what's that? And we made that commitment. And some days I know that she has doubted whether she wants to do that or not anymore. And some people, when they say the so help me God, it's like, so help me God, I'm sticking this out. And other people, it's like, so help me God. You know, it's almost a plea, a desperation. And at different points in your marriage, it can be that way. Either a declaration or literally a request, but it is a big commitment. It is a serious thing where you're taking your identity and somebody else's identity, which are very opposite. Last time I checked, men are very different than women, right? And then, and God, in all of his infinite wisdom, decided to take two very crazy different people and make them one. And it's a beautiful thing when it is done in a way where we serve and we love. It's as you wish. I love you. I will serve you. I will give you 50% as long as you give me 50%, right? No, good. Some people are paying attention. It is not a 50-50 relationship. It is 100%, 100% all the time, whether the other person is giving or not, right? And so we give it all. We give it all. And when you are married and you are putting God first and when you are loving him and you're loving your spouse, marriage is a beautiful thing that over time should get stronger. And if it's not getting stronger, if it's not getting healthier, then I hope and I pray that you would do a little gut check, step back, say, what are we doing wrong here that's not in line with God's word? What are we doing that's off in this? So we're going to look at five main areas in regards to your family and marriage. Five, asking you to commit to five practices to help ultimately fail-proof your family. So we have them up here. Number one, we kind of have them symbolized down in the bottom here. First is we're going to seek God. Then we're going to raise well. We're going to fight fair and have pure fun and never quit. If those will fill in, there we go. So we have the, if we got it over here. So we have the seek God, raise well, fight fair, pure fun, and never quit. And I really want you to commit that even to memory over the next 5 weeks as we explore these things. So everybody say that with me. Seek God, raise well, fight fair, pure fun, never quit. And if you didn't say that, come on, don't be a bump on the log. Let's say that one more time. Seek God, raise well, fight fair, pure fun, and never quit. So we're going to unpack those over these coming weeks and explore what God would have to say to us over those. Memorize those, internalize these areas of your relationship. So the first one, seek God. And if you're taking notes, putting that in there. Seeking God is our first and foremost priority to have to fail-proof your marriage. The problem is that most people are seeking people. They're out to try to find the spouse to make them happy. They're putting a person in the place of God. And a lot of times, guys will be like, well, she smells so pretty. And I like being around her. And so she's the one for me, right? And the gals, they're like, oh, but I like him. That's my girl voice. You just got to bear with it. He's so cute, right? He talks. You know, enjoy it while it lasts, right? And he's just adorable. And then that's the focus. That's the goal. That's what you're seeking after. And it stops there for so many people. And you never get past some of those things. And so many people will say this, I've found the one. I've met the one. Heard that before? I've met the one. He's so wonderful, right? And I've only ever heard this once or twice, where rather than focusing on some of those things, where I actually heard somebody say, I'm so excited because I found a person that I can that loves to read the Bible with me, that prays with me on a regular basis, that they love going to church and worshiping God alongside with me. And I've never heard this, but I would challenge your perspective on this, is instead of saying, the one, I found the one, is saying, I found my two. Because God's your one. And taking a different perspective. I've told Mel this before. I love you second. Because I love God first. And we're going to unpack that a little bit. But to really grab a hold of this concept of saying, I've found my two. And anybody that would take offense or not understand that, they're probably not connecting at the level that you're connecting if that's what you're seeking. Because the thing is, another person cannot handle being your one. They weren't made to do it. They can't. No person can handle your worship or idolizing them. And that's what oftentimes it boils down to. So write this down. God is your one. Your spouse is your two. Let's just keep this in priority here. Let's keep this in proper check. Jesus was actually asked, what is the most important commandment? And I think he might have said something like this. He said, love your spouse with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and all your strength. Is that what he said? It's not what he said. He said what? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and all your strength, right? Now, I'm not saying don't love your spouse. What I'm saying is first in everybody's life, should be God. And I've sat down with so many couples where their God became money, their God became their time, their God became their job, their God became their spouse, or their partner, or their boyfriend or fiance. Anything outside of God being your one is a form of idolatry, and that can be your spouse. And for a while it seems good, but we're gonna get into how destructive that can be. So the first is put God first, and that's the first and greatest commandment. And the second is this, love your neighbor as yourself. God is your one, your spouse is your two. You want a blessed marriage? Anybody in here want to have the absolute best marriage, future or current, that you can possibly have? Anybody here want that? Some people maybe. You didn't really raise your hand. Anybody want that with me? I want the best marriage I can have in every possible way. No holds barred. You want to learn how to serve God together. You want successful kids? Put God first. You want financial blessings? Put God first. You want to make an eternal difference in your life beyond just doing things that last for now? Put God first. Don't seek things first. Seek God first. What does that look like in your life? And the thing is, every person in this room is different. From Kevin to Brian, right? From Joe to Leonard over there. Everybody right now, when you think about what does it mean to put God first, the Holy Spirit's putting something different on your heart. What is it that he's putting in your heart? Saying, hey, you've been putting this in front of me. It's holding me back. It's holding you back from me. What is it that's in your life that you need to adjust? And if you're dating somebody right now and they're not putting God first and you see the pitfall and you're okay with 50-50, go ahead and continue that relationship. But if they're not putting God first, you kick them to the curb. Your odds are way better going out and finding somebody new that actually will put God first with you. So, in fact, you read in Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, it says, but seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. In other words, seek first his ways, his plans, and all the rest of these things will be added to you. And if you're in here and you're, who's under the age of 18 in this room? Under the age of 18. And if you're 40, put your hand back down. You're under the age of 18. This stuff especially applies to you. As we get, some of the things we're going to talk about from here on out especially applies to you, okay? If you're not married yet, be seeking the one and preparing for the two. Be seeking the one and preparing for the two. You know the best way, guys, you know the best way to get ready for your future girlfriend is? Be a man of character. Be a man of integrity. Get a job, right? How many women here are like, I want a guy that has a job, right? I want a guy that can work, right? If he doesn't have a job, ditch him. Say, come back and talk to me again when you actually can hold down a job. Serious. Let him prove his character first. Okay? Otherwise you'll be... Yeah, never mind. Okay. Thing is, who's heard of Andy Stanley? Great leadership stuff. Great North Point Community Church. Does a great work. And he told this story because a lot of people think, well, I will get it all together and I'll start seeking God after I find my spouse, we get married, we have a couple children, then maybe I'll start getting back into church. That's the way a lot of people think. That's the way a lot of Christians operate. I'll get right with God and I'll put him first later, right? So Andy Stanley tells the story of a girl who thought that exact same thing. She's like, you know what, I love God, and I'll do whatever I want to do for a while, and then later on, I'll start serving him when I kind of get things together and get some of the things that I want. So she becomes this party girl. And a true story, she's sleeping around, she's going from party to party, and she's doing whatever she wants, and has developed a little bit of a reputation. And then she comes across one of these guys, and she's like, man, this guy's amazing. I really like this guy. I think he's got all these qualities that I've always wanted. And Andy Stanley tells this story about how she goes to her mom and she's like, Mom, I think I found the guy. Now, he doesn't really know me that much yet, but I think I want to kind of make myself available to him. And I want to, start, being available here. And her mom looks at her and she says, sweetheart, a guy like that isn't looking for a girl like you. And that should be one of those ouch moments. And when you realize, like, oh, and that could be kind of hard for a mom to say. But the thing is, like attracts like. And a guy that's really trying to live with integrity and purity isn't going to be looking for this sleep around kind of party girl. Somebody that's sleeping around is probably going to find somebody sleeping around. Like attracts like. So the challenge is to live to be the person that you want to attract. What kind of, you know, we've often said this with girls and dressing modestly. You know, you will catch whatever kind of bait you're using to attract. And if you're dressing, you know, risque and very immodestly, you're going to probably find a guy who's attracted to that instead of your inner beauty. So make the guy wonder. Make the guy learn about you and be drawn after your character and your personality. Grow that. Become the type of person you'd like to marry one day. Gals, guys, young people in the room especially, and those that even, you know, if that's something that's on your heart to someday get married, be the kind of person that you would like to someday marry. And if you are married, always, here this one's for you. I will always seek the one with my two. I will always seek the one with my two. You can't put God fifth or sixth on the line. We have to put him first. And doing that with our spouse, with our partner, putting God first. So how do we seek God first? We're going to unpack that in just a second, but I want to say this. You cannot ask your spouse to do something that they're not capable of. They are not capable of being perfect. And oftentimes we expect them to be. And often what happens when we find somebody, we either idolize them or we demonize them. We look at, you know, guys, you see this girl and she's like, oh, she's so organized and she's so driven and she's so passionate. And you're like, I love her, right? And then you marry her and you're worshiping her and you're like, oh my goodness, she's a control freak and she nags me all the time. It goes from idolizing to demonizing, right? And the guy's, oh, He's so gentle and he comforts me and he's so laid back. I just love him. That's idolizing. And then later on you're like, he's a lazy bum and he plays video games all the time. Same characteristics, different perspective, right? From idolizing to demonizing. Because they are not capable of being your number one. And when you expect them, when you put them there, they will fail you and you will be let down. And that's not a good place to be. So how do we seek God? I actually had a whole other direction I was going to go. I was going to list off 100 different things of what you can do to seek God. And I'm like, you know what? I'm lucky if I can remember 5 things and apply them. Maybe we should just focus on one. So just I had this whole other message that was going to go down these lines of how do we seek God? We pray together. We read God's word together. We worship together. We create our own spiritual traditions. And we do life with God. And these things that are important, I don't know if they actually made it in the slides there, but this praying together, reading God's word together, worshiping together, creating your own spiritual traditions, and doing life with God. And those things are all important, but ultimately, if we try to unpack that, most of us won't retain a lot of it. And so I wanted to, you know, and just a verse to go with it, Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him. And he will do what? He'll make your path straight. Put him first. Put him first. And he makes your path straight. And he's to be woven into every area of our lives. The thing is, how do we seek God? My figure is we better just focus on one. There's a book called Keystone Habits. Anybody read that book? Okay, there's some great stuff out of it. And it talks about this concept. And the younger you can establish this and grab onto this concept of keystone habits, there's certain key things, like very, very foundational things that if you do this one thing, it creates a positive momentum. We've talked about this before. It creates a positive momentum that builds on the rest of your life. And we used the illustration once that if I floss, then my teeth feel clean, and I feel good about myself. If I feel good about myself, I'm more likely to work out. If I work out more, I feel stronger. And if I feel stronger, I'm just overall more confident, and I'm not going to be down, and then I love my wife more, and she compliments me more, and then I'm just in a better attitude. I don't feel the need to speed, and I'm just a better pastor, right? Whereas if I don't floss, Keystone habit, my teeth are gross. I feel bad about myself. If I feel bad about myself, I don't work out. If I don't work out, I feel sloth, and then I run behind. And then when I'm running behind, then I feel the need to speed down the road, and I get car sirens behind me, right? So then I try to outrun them, and I flip the car, roll over in the ditch, they throw me in jail, and I get fired as a pastor. Why? Because I didn't floss. You see where I'm going? So this concept of Keystone Habits. So if there's one thing I want you to get out of this message today, and it's not flossing. Oh, that's a good thing. And I'm not a dental hygienist, and I'm not sponsored by any of them. yeah, this is not a commercial for Crest or Colgate. But Keystone Habit. Because the thing is, if you're looking for something, most of us are pretty good at finding it. If I said, girls, I'm going to pay for a pedicure or a manicure for you, all you got to do is find a salon. What would you do? You'd find, okay, I'm Googling it right now, right? Right? Guys, if I said I'm paying for 18 holes of golf, supplying you the clubs, giving you top-notch balls, all you got to do is go find the golf course. What would you do? Some of you be like, I don't care about golf. Right? And others are like, you know, I'm running out the door right now to go find it. You know, if you lost your cell phone, what do? You go find it. And who's honest? You've driven back home to get your cell phone because you left it there. Honest people in the room. See? See? If it's important, in fact, the more important it is to you, the harder you look, right? The more important it is, the harder you look. If you lose your car keys, you will seek them and probably get after the kids for supposedly misplacing them when it was probably actually your fault, right? Psalm chapter 10, verses 4 to 6. In his pride, the wicked does not seek God. In all his thoughts, there's no room for God. He says to himself, nothing will shake me. I'll always be happy and never have trouble. 1 Chronicles 28:9. Worship and serve him with your whole heart and a willing mind. For the Lord sees every heart and knows every plan and thought. If you seek him, you will find him. It's not if you seek him, maybe you'll find him. Okay, God makes himself available. When we seek him, we gotta have that desire. Look for him. Watch and see him working. And it doesn't have to be just a devotional time. Okay, now I'm gonna sit down, I'm gonna have devotions, and I'm gonna look for God. Weave him into every moment of every day of your life. Okay? Your relationship with God is not meant to be on Sundays alone or Wednesdays. He wants to have a personal relationship with you every day. Every day. Every moment of every day. Not just when you're praying over your meals. So much more than that. So, the keystone habit that I want you to get, that I want you to grab onto, is pray together every day. If you can get that one thing as a couple, it can transform, and I believe it will transform your marriage. And the thing is, it's an incredibly intimate thing. Praying with your spouse, it's an intimate thing. In fact, whenever I'm doing marriage coaching, I sit with couples, and when we're done at the end of that session, we always have them take hands, hold hands, and pray over each other. And for some of them, it's incredibly weird. They've never done it before. But it can be incredibly intimate. So if you're dating, I highly encourage you, don't go snuggle up on the couch and start praying with each other. Don't lay on a bed and pray with each other. Don't do horizontal prayer with them, okay? Go stand in the kitchen, hold their hands, and pray, okay? If you're married, pray in bed. It's fine. Not many of you got that one. Prayer is an intimate thing. And it draws two people together. And this is the thing. You can apply this to your marriage. Many people don't use this, they use it for the nation, but you can apply this verse to your marriage. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear them from heaven, forgive their sins, and heal their marriage. You can easily substitute their marriage in with that. You can easily put that in there. It's intimidating for some. And let me make it easy. Don't just make it routine, but just start. Just start. You just grab their hand and you just pray something simple. You don't even have to know how to pray. You can keep your eyes open. I had the privilege of sitting out with a couple the other day, and they had no idea. They'd never done it before. And they're like, do we close our eyes? What do we do? And you just say what you want over them and talk to God about it. And a very, very simple, very heartfelt thing. The thing is, it is hard to pray when you're mad at somebody, isn't it? Anybody tried that? Having an argument and you take each other's hand and you pray. Is it easy to stay mad? It is hard. It is incredibly hard to be mad at each other. It is difficult to have an affair when you're praying with your spouse. It is incredibly difficult. It is incredibly difficult to seek out or be involved in any kind of addictions, especially addictions of infidelity, when you're praying with your spouse, especially when you're honest in praying with your spouse. There is incredible power in praying together as a couple. And if you're having a hard time with it, you can write it out. I say, man, I'd love to pray this thing over them. You can shoot it to them in a text and say, I'm praying this over you. Just to get it started. You know, I don't know about you, but I love it when I get adorable, you know, encouraging texts from my wife. It just does something special inside, doesn't it? And so oftentimes we have drama on our text messages and Facebook stuff, right? But isn't it encouraging isn't it just adorable when you see some woman post these lovey-dovey things about her husband, appropriate ones, of course? Isn't it just, you're almost like, oh, that makes me sick, right? But inside, you're like, oh, it's so cute. I wish I was doing that. There's something encouraging and special about involving God in every area of our lives. When we pray together, it's so powerful. And it doesn't have to look like a church prayer. It's just literally taking their hands, being honest, and praying to God. And the thing is, there's statistics. There's a lot of statistics on this. Family Life did a survey where they surveyed, it was a few years back, but they surveyed thousands of Christians, the couple, Christian couples. And of those that were interviewed, only 8% of couples said they prayed together. Christian couples. Only 8% pray together. That's a staggering statistic. There's something wrong with that picture, right? And some guys in here are like, oh my goodness, you're wanting me to pray with my wife? And women are like, yay, pastor told you that you have to pray with me. Guys, I'm challenging you. Just do, especially men in this room, you are the spiritual head of your home, and I challenge you in this. At some point, take your wife's hands. We have some fun with this in our family. We've almost fallen over praying. We bring the whole family in, all the kids. Okay, come on, kids, and we bring them into a huddle and we squeeze it. We almost have fallen over while we're praying over each other. A lot of fun. Mix it up a little bit. Have some fun with it. But just do it. Just do it. Right? Nike had it right. When it comes to praying for with your spouse, what does Nike say? Just do it. Be a man and pray with your spouse. But of those that pray together, those 8% that actually pray together, fewer than 1% of those families have ever gotten divorced. 99% of the couples that pray together stay together. You think there's a reason they have that quote? Now, I know if your spouse is not a Christian, that makes it hard, doesn't it? That makes it challenging. And I would encourage you to be regularly praying over them, praying for them, that God would get a hold of their heart. And some of you, you know, you're just fine with the 50-50. Hey, you know what? I'm okay with the risk that my marriage could fall apart. I'm okay with it not being satisfactory. I'm okay with constantly struggling. I don't know about you, but I'm done with that way of thinking. And I commit on a regular basis to pray over my spouse and to pray over my kids. And if every person in here grabbed a hold of this one simple concept and you went home and you prayed with your spouse on a regular basis. Now, what if you miss praying today? What do? You pray tomorrow. Oh my goodness, honey, we forgot to pray yesterday. God's going to kill us now. No, don't be religious about it. What do you do if you forgot to pray yesterday? You pray today. Okay? You pick up. What do I do if I forgot to floss yesterday? Floss today. Right? You just pick up. And you keep doing it. Unless the Lord builds the house, it labors build in vain. Now, I asked my wife something that at first I thought was kind of weird. I'm like, okay, God, this is weird. For a lot of people, this might be uncomfortable. But I asked my wife to come up, and one of the things that we do is we pray over each other. And we pray, sure, and we pray for each other. And it doesn't have to be crazy fancy. It can be super simple. So I'm like, honey, what if we just, at the end of the message, we just come up and you pray over me and I pray over you?
You guys ready for an exorcism?
What? That's not going to happen. Am I praying for you like that? Sure, you can read it that way if you want. So I just asked if she would pray.
That was a plug for our demonology class on Wednesday night, so, yeah.
Maybe we should start a marriage class on Wednesday nights. I'll teach it and you can sit in it. Or the other way, that's what I was actually thinking.
Whoa.
I love you. So, you want to pray first, you want me to?
Whatever you want.
No? Classic answer.
Oh,
you want to go first?
You go first.
I'll go first. Okay. Okay. So if you would, even just bow your heads with us. Or in fact, what I would encourage, if you're sitting next to somebody that you're dating or if engaged to or married to, then just grab their hand or put your arm around them and just kind of pray along with us. I'm going first?
Yeah.
Okay. Heavenly Father, I thank you for my wife. I thank you for the character that you're building in her. I thank you for the love that she has for you. Father, I pray that you would strengthen her every day. Father, help her to stand against the attacks that the enemy would bring her way. Help her to stand against discouragement. Help her to know she's beautiful. Help her to know always that I love her. Father, help me to be the man that I need to be. Help me to be the man that she deserves. Help me to put you first, Lord. And love her second, but with all of my heart. Help me to grow every day and to learn. Help me to serve her because she deserves it and because I love you so much.
God, I thank you for my husband. I just pray right now, I pray life into him. I pray any words that have been spoken against him to fall off right now in the name of Jesus. God, I pray that you give him strength and integrity and help him to continue on in the character that you have given him as he loves you and he honors you. God, I pray that I could give him a reason to smile during the day, and I pray that he will fix my kitchen sink. Well, mostly just the cupboards and the countertops. Amen. No.
Hint taken. Honey, you know, you don't have to keep nagging me about that. You once every 6 months is more than enough. Come on. I love you. It doesn't have to be fancy, but do it. Do it. Pray together. And if it's weird, oh well, you'll grow past that. There is power. And it's either you choose to start doing it now, or in desperation, you give me a call at whatever hour of the night, and you're like, Pastor, can we meet? Because so-and-so is being a jerk, and we can't figure this out. And some of you call, and some of you just say, forget it, call the lawyer, we're getting a divorce. But I know, I can almost guarantee that if you pray together, whether it's like that or your version, and I know that there's other couples in here, and it's so beautiful to see that you pray together, and you love God, and God's doing things in your life. And there's other of you like, man, I wish. And the thing is, there's few things more powerful than a role model. And I remember her grandpa as a spiritual patriarch in the family, literally taking us in. We were at family reunion, and he pulled us in, and he put his hands on us, and he prayed a blessing over us and spoke into our lives. And every once in a while, they've written us notes of prayers that they're speaking into our lives. There is power in that. There are things happening in your spouse's life that you don't know and you can't understand because you're a woman and he's a man and you don't get it. Or he's a, you know, men, you don't understand about her because that's just not possible, actually, I think, to understand. No, I still do not understand my wife. And that's okay. She's a woman. God made her that way. And I think some of that's the mystery of her. But I can pray over her that she knows that she's loved and that she's beautiful. And I can speak. And you could speak that into your spouse's life as well, or your fiancé's, or your dates, your boyfriend, your girlfriend's life. And if they push back on that, you're like, God has been doing this in my heart. God has been saying to me, I need to do this. And if they push back and say, I don't want anything to do with that. If you're dating them, ditch them. Just say, that's the, you know, until they can come around on that. You're not a missionary for them, okay? Not sure why I'm putting that in at the end, but what's the challenge today? Pray together. Pray together. Always pray together. Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord, for your goodness. I thank you that you love us. I thank you that it's your love that draws us to you. It's not your condemnation, you're beating us on the head. It's your kindness that draws us to repentance. And Father, I pray over every couple here today. And I pray over those that are even seeking to be a couple. Lord, I pray that you would help them to be what they want to ultimately marry. Help them to be that person of character. Help them to put you first and prepare for their number two. Father, help us to draw closer to you every single day. And there's some of you here that you have not been seeking God first. You have not been putting God first. You haven't been allowing him to be the leader of your home. Your spouse has been your one, and God has been somewhere on the list. Or your partner, your boyfriend or girlfriend or fiance, you've been having it in the wrong priority and haven't been always putting God first. And if you're here this morning and you'd be willing to just admit and say, I need God's help to him be my one and that I prepare for the two. And if that's you here, just lift your hand up and say, God, help me to put you first in my relationships. Help me to put you first. Help me to put you first. There's hands up all over the place. Heavenly Father, I pray that you would help us, that you would show the areas in our lives that are not honoring you right and align us with what it is that you truly want. What it is that you truly want for us. God, help us to make this keystone commitment to pray together every day, to pray together every day. And if you're here and you've been honest with God, if you seek him, you will find him. There's some of you here this morning, you can put your hands down. There's some of you here this morning that you've never actually known God to even be able to put him first in your life. And he's calling you today, saying, I want to be number one in your life. I want you to lay things before me. The cool thing is God died for your sins. God paid the price that you couldn't pay. And he set the stage for you to be able to ask him to be your one. And if you're here this morning and you've never asked him to be in that spot, you've never asked him to forgive your sins, and today you would say, I need to do that. I need to let him be first in my life. If that's you this morning, just lift your hand up and say, I need to ask Jesus into my heart to be my number one. Anybody in here that would say that this morning? Thank you for being honest. Thank you. Anybody else this morning? Thank you for being honest in the back there. Praise the Lord. Anybody else? This is a huge decision, a special decision. Thank you. God is so